ACL, and Mike Leake, who does a nice job with the bat.
Defensively here tonight, Soriano in left, Jackson in center, DeJesus over in right field. It'll be Valbuena, Castro, Barney, and Rizzo third to first across the infield. Steve Clevenger doing the catching tonight for right-hander Chris Volstead. Glenn mentioned seven strong innings against the Dodgers last time out. That was a 3-1 Cubs loss. He gave up only six base hits, walked one batter in that game, and was able to avoid the dreaded big inning, which has been his downfall this season.
Once we get started, the game is in the hands of the crew chief, Jeff Nelson, in terms of if it starts raining, whether or not we continue. Porter, Wolf, and Culpa on the bases. It's just one of those nights where the sky has had an interesting look at different points in time. In fact, Bob, about 45 minutes ago, we saw a rainbow.
A little bit of sunshine peeking through the clouds as it was raining here at Wrigley Field, but a lot of dark clouds in the area right now. I'm not a weatherman, but looking at the radar, we should have a window here for a while, but more rain is in store for later this evening.
Reds with a couple of Rookie of the Year candidates. Zach Cozart, one of those guys. Todd Frazier, the other. Reds without Joey Votto, who's on the disabled list after knee surgery. And Scott Rowland dealing with some soreness as well. But the Reds have done it this year based on their pitching staff. Tap toward third. It's foul.
Offense comes sputtering on this road trip, batting only 186 as a team, including 1-for-14 with runners in scoring position, and have stranded 20 base runners.
It's outside on a breaking ball, and it's 2-2. A 1 hour, 20 minute rain delay prior to the first pitch. There's former Cub manager Dusty Baker. Talked about it during our open almost an hour and a half ago. The Reds have lost four in a row. That ties a season long losing streak. But before this current stretch, they had rattled off 22 out of 25. And in 19 years as a big league manager, Dusty never had seen one of his teams win that many games in such a short time span. In fact, it's the best 25-game stretch the Reds have had in the modern era. Only the 1890 Reds had a better 25-game stretch, or as good. They won 22. And a full count now on Cozart. And starting with this game tonight, the Cubs next 11 games, 8 of them against the Reds. The other 3 will be versus the Houston Astros. That ball's crushed out into deep left for a leadoff homer for Zach Cozart. That's his 13th of the season. As the Reds jump out on top.
Elevated fastball at 92, belt high, right down the middle of the plate. You mentioned Cozart, a Rookie of the Year candidate. Hitting leadoff home runs, you'll get more votes.
Not the way Chris Volstead wanted to start. 3-2 pitch that was up. Here's Drew Stubbs, the center fielder. So with that home run, the top six guys in tonight's Reds lineup all have at least 13 homers on the season. So even though they're without Joey Votto, who has 14, and Scott Rowland has always been a clutch hitter, Reds still have a lot of offensive punch.
It's a fourth leadoff home run for Zach Cozart this season.
By the way, 66 degrees in a northeast wind, just 5 miles an hour. The first time I've had to bring the jacket up to the booth in about 2.5, 3 months. Mm-hmm. Ball four. We have had a very hot summer, as you know, here in Chicago, but pretty cool here today. So a homer and a walk to start it. Now it's Brandon Phillips.
Have to keep an eye on Drew Stubbs over there at first base. 26 steals this season in 32 attempts. Far and away their best stolen base threat in this Reds lineup.
Phillips last week missed 5 games with a strained left calf. He's taken over that third spot with Votto on the DL. Joey Votto may not be out much longer. Do not expect to see him in this series. We might next week.
Don't want to upset team chemistry by bringing him back, huh?
They're 16-7 without their best player.
How about that? Miguel Cairo and Todd Frazier doing most of the filling in over there at first base.
Sure, Dusty would tell you, when you get the consistent pitching the Reds have, they've only used 5 starting pitchers all year. Their bullpen has been lights out. You can sustain the loss of a position player or two at times.
You mentioned that Reds bullpen, Len. It's amazing to look at Aroldis Chapman's numbers. He's got as many strikeouts as 3 of the starting pitchers in the Reds rotation in only 53 innings of work.
He's the closer. He pitches 1 inning per appearance. Stubbs takes off and Phillips fouls back. He got a pretty good jump over there. He may not have the starting speed of a Tony Campana, but when he gets those long legs moving, he might be the fastest guy in the league. Slider misses low. Big lead by Stubbs, and Volstead checks on him.
And just to finish that thought about the speed of Drew Stubbs as compared to somebody like Tony Campana or D. Gordon, one of the real burners in the league. I think in a 90-foot race, the little guys would win, but if you race from foul pole to foul pole, I think Drew Stubbs would blow them away.
Yeah, you're right.
And you really notice it when Stubbs is playing defensively out in center field. He covers a tremendous amount of ground.
Volstead grinding here. This will be his 18th pitch of the inning. Just the third batter he's faced. Stubbs not running. That's bounced to third. It's a foul ball.
In Chris Volstead's defense, this is one of the toughest situations for any starting pitcher. You go down to begin your warm-ups in the bullpen, then the rain starts, so they cover the mounds again. You have to sit and wait and wait and wait. You're never sure exactly what the start time for the ball game is going to be. So understandable that he's a little shaky here in the first inning. But he needs to settle in quickly because this Reds offense is not going to wait on him.
Yeah, it looked like he threw a couple of warm-up tosses before they put the tarp back on the field. I don't believe Mike Leake ever did throw a pitch before that second delay.
That's a luxury you have as a visiting team under these circumstances, because obviously Mike Leake won't pitch until the bottom of the first inning. He takes his cue from the home pitcher. So Mike Leake was going to wait until Chris Volstad began his warm-up tosses and probably got about 5 minutes into that process before he decided to start.
Stubbs runs on the 2-2, and that one floated out into right, sending Stubbs to third.
I think that's really a hit and run. That's just Brandon Phillips knowing that Drew Stubbs was going to be on the move, trying to shoot that ball through the right side of the infield. That time it was a soft liner into right, putting Reds on the corners.
For veteran left fielder Ryan Ludwig. The Pirates lost earlier today, so the Reds lead increased from 2.5 to 3. Have the second best record in the major leagues. 66-45. Only the Washington Nationals have a better record at 68-43. Let me give you the updated look at the standings. The Cardinals were a winner today, so they're now within 5.5. We'll have details on those afternoon games as we move along. Swing and a miss, 1-1. So Ludwig has been pretty hot here lately. He has 74 hits. 40 of those hits have gone for extra bases.
And as you pointed out, Len, there's no question this Reds team so far this year has all been about their pitching. But you look at their offense, they've got 7 players in double digits in home runs already. They don't steal a lot of bases with the exception of Drew Stubbs, but the guys that do run have stolen at a very high percentage. There's enough veteran hitters in the lineup with guys like Ryan Ludwig, Votto, when healthy, Scott Rowland, Jay Bruce, guys that know how to move that ball around the field, find the weaknesses in the defense, set up a pitcher.
Ludwig actually could be a comeback player of the year candidate. This could be 2, knocked down by Valbuena. It's only going to be 1. That's the first out. Ludwig will get his 58th RBI. It's the first out of the ball game, and it's 2-0 Cincinnati. Here comes the right fielder, Jay Bruce. Ludwig, the last couple of years, really scuffling, particularly last year when he split the season between the Padres and the Pirates, but he's back. Bruce, a 2-time All-Star, takes a strike. Do you think it has anything to do with the ballpark? Ryan Ludwig playing in Petco Park, PNC Park, and now at Great American Ballpark.
Yeah, Great American Ballpark would fit inside either one of those other two stadiums. And the lineup around you as well. You know, you get some professional hitters in front and behind a professional hitter like Ryan Ludwig, and his numbers are going to go up just by osmosis. You mentioned Brandon Phillips missed five games last week with a strained left calf. I assume that he would be very cautious on the bases, but he's jumping around out there at second base like he wants to steal third.
One, two to Bruce. Backdoor curveball. Now 2-2. Todd Frazier on deck. He's slugging over 500. Been filling in a lot for Joey Votto, but playing third tonight. Swing and a miss. Strike three. We're out number two.
Our Nissan pitch track strikeout number 100 of the season for Jay Bruce comes on a fastball up and in. There's not a lot of breaks in this Reds lineup. You mentioned Todd Frazier, another rookie of the year candidate. Leads all National League rookies with triples, second in homers, RBIs, and slugging percentage, as you said, over 500.
For a while, and I did think it was a bit unfair. Dusty Baker, everyone said he's not a guy who likes to play rookies. Well, he's got a couple here who've been a big part of their offense.
I don't think that's a determining factor for any manager. You want guys that can play. You don't care if they're 40 or 20. They can get the job done. Put them in the lineup.
Who wouldn't want Mike Trout? Bryce Harper. There's a 1-2. Frazier almost offered at it. Slider outside. Full count, 3-2. Former Cub Miguel Cairo would hit next. He's playing first.
It's hard to tell because Volstead hasn't had great command so far in this first inning of the ball game, but with a base open and the dangerous Todd Frazier at the plate, Cairo in the on deck circle, who's not having a good offensive year, could be a pitch around.
He freezes him on strike three, a 35 pitch first inning in which the Reds get two. The Cubs are coming up against righty Mike Leake. against righty Mike Leake. They were shut out twice in that series in San Diego. But maybe some home cooking will change things. DeJesus, Barney Rizzo, 1-3. Soriano, Castro, and Valbuena in the middle. Brett Jackson in his Wrigley Field debut in center. Steve Clevenger, the catcher. Chris Folstad, the pitcher.
Take a look at the Cincinnati defense. Only the Braves have made fewer errors in the National League this year. It'll be Ludwig, Stubbs, and Bruce left to right across the outfield. Frazier, Cozart, Phillips, and Cairo, third to first across the infield. Devin Mesoraco doing the catching tonight for diminutive right-hander Mike Leake.
5'11", 180. The old school stirrups working.
Yeah, has a full complement of pitches. He'll sink his fastball. He'll cut his fastball. Throws a slider, a curve, a changeup, and maybe even invent some while he's out there on the mound.
One-0 pitch to DeJesus is low and away. Leake has struggled lately to a 7.29 ERA over his last four starts. Cubs hoping those struggles continue.
Yeah, over the course of those last four starts, he's given up a career-high 11 hits against the Arizona Diamondbacks. Gave up two home runs in that game. That was a career-high. Had a good outing against the Houston Astros. Gave up two runs in eight innings of work. And then followed that up with the shortest outing of his career. Only an inning and two-thirds against the Padres.
Foul tip to make it 2-2. Mentioned the Reds have used five starters. That's it. It's a modern franchise record. We'll see four of those five in this series. The only one we won't see is Matt Latos. And a base hit into right. Jay Bruce coming over. The slide, a nice play, but DeJesus will have a double.
Days, who's starting to square the ball up with regularity once again, like he did through most of the early part of the season. This time a ringing double down into the right field corner. Nice sliding play by Jay Bruce just to hold DeJesus to a double.
And with that, it has started to rain again. You know, I was a few seconds away from saying it's turned into a lovely night. But as you said, several cells passing through the area. It's high for ball one. Yeah, this streak of using just five starters is going to end pretty soon. That's because of the makeup day-night doubleheader. The Reds will play against the Cubs next weekend in Cincy. Will be on the 18th. Elias reporting the longest the Reds have had. The 1898 staff went 147 games with five guys making every start. You remember old Still Bill Hill?
Still Bill, yeah. Bill Withers.
Barney moves that runner to third with one out. Remember Pink Hawley?
Don't recall.
Ted Breitenstein?
No, keep trying.
Frank Dwyer, Bill Damon.
You had me at Still Bill Hill. Okay.
Think about that team. They may not have needed a reliever all year. As the Cubs get on the board, Rizzo with a base hit. So he knocks in his 24th run of the year, and it's 2-1.
Just bangs that sinker into the dirt. That's a big break for the Cubs right there. The fact that Leake deflected that ball to the right of Zach Cozart. He tries to make a barehanded play. I don't believe they would have had Rizzo at first. They definitely would not have had David DeJesus at home. And the Cubs are on the board.
Good to see them answer back. And still only one out in the inning. Here's Alfonso Soriano. Just 1-for-13 against Leak.
Mentioned the Reds have seven players in their offense that have had at least double digits in homers. The Cubs, by comparison, only three. Starlin Castro with his 11, Brian LaHair with 14, and the man at the plate with 19.
He's been sitting on 19 since July 24th when he connected off the Pirates' James McDonald. Look out, Starlin Castro. How you pull a ball that far. Can you pull a ball behind yourself?
Oh, I've seen it done, yeah. You get fooled by an off-speed pitch that happens to be up and in off the plate, and you end up hooking it right back over your own shoulder. For all the weather we have in the vicinity here tonight, right now, wind is really not doing much of anything.
Swing and a miss for out number two. Shortstop number 13. Starlin Castro. Snap the 0-for-21 with a base hit in the sixth inning yesterday in San Diego, but just 1-for-22 on the trip. Did walk three times. Comes in a 273 on the year. And this will be Drew Stubbs in center to end the inning. The Cubs get one. And at the end of one, Reds 2, Cubs 1. Presented by Meijer is coming up this Saturday as the Cubs battle the Reds here at Wrigley. Visit Gate D before the game through the second inning to make a donation and help support the local work of Lakeview Pantry. A donation of $20 gets you an autographed Cubs player photo and allows the pantry to purchase 200 pounds of food. For more information, call 773-404-CUBS. Yeah, that kind of night. Be prepared for the elements. 2-1 Cincinnati as we start the second, and a called strike. Veteran utility man Miguel Cairo. Chris Volstead struggling in that first inning against the Reds in two different starts this year. Back on April 20th in a 9-4 loss, he made 41 pitches in the first inning. Tonight had to throw 35. Good slider, 1-2.
Pretty easy to figure Miguel Cairo's batting average right now. He's 16 for 100. Even I can figure that one out.
Yeah, you like him rounded off like that. Problem is, you can't go from 100 to 200 at bats in one day. Castro slipped. Dropped it, and that's an error.
He just took his eye off the ball. He slipped after the error.
Also looked, Bob, like his line, like he may have been able to cut that ball off a little sooner and avoid the grass. But is that one of those plays where you know you've got a little extra time with a veteran running, and so maybe you don't play that as aggressively?
Yeah, you lay back and look for the big hop rather than possibly charging and smothering that ball on a short hop. I know it's been a struggle, and it's obvious that Starlin Castro is frustrated, but he's really out of sync with the game here early. That fly ball he hit to center field to in the bottom half of the first inning, he barely made it to first base. Jogged halfway down the line carrying his bat. Got to first base, handed his helmet to Dave McKay, the first base coach, who gave him a little bit of a scolding.
Mesoraco fouls out. Devin Mesoraco was on the concussion DL, just came off tonight, and got right into the lineup. And then here's Mike Leake. Cubs should know his hitting prowess well. Sees 275 with a couple of home runs. He has 38 hits over the last three seasons. That's the most among all pitchers. And in his major league debut against the Cubs, he had two hits. That was on April 11th of 2010. Pushes a bunt to Rizzo. He'll fire to second. Out there. Cubs got a break. I think they got a big break as Dusty Baker's going to come out. It looked like Starlin had already jumped off the bag to avoid Cairo, but was given the out call. We'll get another look at it, but Dusty wants an explanation.
Yeah, I saw the same thing you did, the high throw.
Well, he did stay
on. With the naked eye, it looked like Castro came off the bag before he caught the throw from Anthony Rizzo. But on the replay, he was able to at least keep part of the shoe on the bag to get the force out at second base.
A long argument. Jim Wolf made the call at second, and he got it right. Cozart led off the game with a home run. Leake now takes over at first. And there's a strike on the outside. While the Cubs have lost eight in a row, they've been really good here at Wrigley Field, winning 13 of their last 18 at home. Tonight's game starts a seven-game homestand. backpedaling is Darwin Barney, and this will end the inning. So an error, no runs. We go to the bottom of the second. 2-1 Reds. Part of it with Vineline, the official magazine of the Chicago Cubs. Vineline gives you insider access to all your favorite Cubs from the past, present, and future. Subscriptions start at just $29.95. For more info and to order, visit cubs.com/Vineline. Cubs will bat here in the second, trailing 2-1. The big bits of news in the Cubs organization. Jorge Soler, the outfielder, promoted from rookie league Mesa to low A Peoria. I don't think he was in the lineup tonight, but jumping a level. So he didn't even go to Boise. He went right from Mesa to Peoria. You get a chance to get that adrenaline going a little bit. The crowds will be a lot bigger in the Midwest League. So we'll keep an eye on Jorge Soler as Luis Valbuena looks at a strike.
And then we've talked about the Red shortstop Zach Cozart, how he's a rookie of the year candidate, having himself a real nice first season at the major league level. But you get the feeling he's just keeping that position warm for young Billy Hamilton. About him earlier this season. He's a shortstop in the Reds organization, currently playing in Pensacola Double A in the Southern League. He started the year in Bakersfield in A ball. In 82 games in Bakersfield, he stole 104 bases, was caught 21 times, promoted to Double A, where he's stolen 27 bases and been caught 6 times in only 27 games. Sure, Billy Hamilton plays other positions, but it's a nice dilemma to have if you're the Cincinnati Reds. A rookie of the year candidate playing short in the big leagues and a guy that's going to be knocking on the door very shortly.
In on the hands and popped. Foul ground caught by Cairo.
Center fielder number 7, Brett Jackson.
So here's Brett Jackson. His Wrigley debut. He takes a strike. Two hits and a walk in his debut on Sunday, scored a run. Four strikeouts Monday. Three strikeouts and a walk on Tuesday. Did not play yesterday. hooks that one foul through the Reds bullpen.
Yeah, probably a good thing Brett Jackson wasn't in the lineup yesterday. Clayton Richard was really good in that road trip finale in San Diego. He was tough on everybody, especially tough on the lefties.
Hitting seventh tonight, and the main reason they wanted to mix up the lefties and righties in his lineup, because when you get to the Reds bullpen, you got a couple of guys named Marshall, you may remember him, and Chapman, who are pretty nasty. Popped up, and it's a shortstop, Cozart, for out number two. Brings up the catcher, Steve Clevenger. 58 at bats here at Wrigley Field in his short career, but he's hit 397 in the friendly confines. Got him on a called third strike. That's two for Leak. Carries a 2-1 lead into the third.
Light for a little while, and then it got real dark and it started to rain, and Wrigley Field turned into the world's largest slip and slide.
Yeah, it was 24 years ago yesterday, our Xfinity high speed action. That game was rained out. The following day, 24 years ago tonight, the Cubs did play their first official night game at Wrigley Field, a 6-4 victory over the New York Mets. Drew Stubbs fouls off. Third inning, we had a 1 hour, 20-minute delay before the first pitch due to rain. Castro gets Stubbs.
Second baseman, Brendan Phillips.
Comes Brandon Phillips. R.A. Dickey with his 15th win, and Jose Reyes had his 26-game hitting streak stopped as the Mets ended a 9-game home losing streak, 6-1 win over the Marlins. Dickey is 15-3. He had that rough patch, but has been really good over his last three. He worked his fourth complete game this season. Ties Jared Weaver for the lead in wins. High fly ball to left, and it's Soriano going back now in a few steps to get Phillips.
Wind has picked up a little bit again, Len, blowing straight in from left field right now. For the first couple innings of this ball game, the flags were hanging straight down all the way around the ballpark, but starting to kick up once again.
Ludwig knocked in a run on a ground out in the first. Cardinals beat the Giants 3-1 in their seventh win in their last 10 games. Adam Wainwright improved to .500 at 10-10. Carlos Beltran, with his 27th homer, he leads the league with 80 RBIs. One ripped into left to keep the inning alive.
A lot of pitches up around the belt. Chris Volstad in this game. Some have been hit extremely hard. Some have been popped up. But I'd like to see him get that sinker down there around the knees. Get some ground balls. Let his defense work behind him on the infield.
Bruce hits a ground ball right to Barney. Lots of time. Inning over. Two out, single, no runs. Middle of the third, still 2-1 Reds. Member of the Cubs Club, the official fan club of the Chicago Cubs. Members will enjoy exclusive perks, experiences, and merchandise throughout the 2012 Cubs season. It's never been a better time to join, rejoin, or give a fellow Cubs fan the gift of a Cubs Club membership. To join today, visit Cubs.com. Here's his starter, Volstad. His first at bat tonight, looking for his first hit this season. Six career extra base hits, they've all been doubles. Two walks, 90 strikeouts. Doesn't strike out here. He will ground out to a Gold Glover, Brandon Phillips.
Just thinking about that, Len, how do you unseat a Gold Glover like Brandon Phillips, which is what Darwin Barney's trying to do this year? Brandon Phillips has won the Gold Glove at second base three of the last four seasons. He only has two errors all year, but exactly the same as Darwin Barney.
It's a difficult thing to do once you've established yourself as a Gold Glove player. It is difficult for somebody else to best you because, you know, by and large, compared to offense, the defense, at least to the naked eye, appears to be fairly stable. Once you're in that elite group, you get the benefit of the doubt, even if you have an off year.
And unfortunately, the Gold Glove Award many times is voted to the guy who not only plays good defense, but is having a good offensive year. And Brandon Phillips hitting 290 going into play tonight. He pops some home runs. And a much more vocal presence on the field and in the interview room than Darwin Barney.
The 1-1 to DeJesus catches the outside. Make it 1-2. Two homers for Jason Kubel today in the Diamondbacks 6-3 win at Pittsburgh. So that's a 2-2 split in that four-game series. Ball to deep right, Jay Bruce on the track.
That very nearly backfired on the Reds right there. You could clearly see Devin Mesoraco, the Reds catcher, getting up out of his crouch, giving that high target. He appeared to hit the target, but David DeJesus gave it a long ride to right field. Adjust your scouting report if a guy gets to that high fastball that you think he's going to swing through.
I was talking with Brett Jackson today and, you know, asking him if he grew up a Giants fan or an A's fan. He's from Berkeley, just north of Oakland. He said, no, the Giants. Dad was a Giants fan, and Darwin Barney was sitting next to him. I said, you know, I never asked you who you rooted for. He said, the Mariners, which makes sense. He's from Oregon. And the Red Sox. Really? Well, the first big league game he ever saw in person was at the Kingdome, the Red Sox and the Mariners. It was A-Rod's rookie year. Lou Piniella would have been the Mariners manager. Darwin would later play for Uncle Lou. Stubbs comes in. Back-to-back 1-2-3 innings for Leak after he gave up one in the first. 2-1 Reds.
The fourth inning is brought to you by the new Doritos Locos Tacos from Taco Bell.
So Bob gets to work usually. Back of the rickshaw. Our Menards Grounds Crew winner, Rebecca Bachman from Chicago. Pretty busy tonight as Todd Frazier cranks one into the basket on the first pitch of the fourth inning, and it's 3-1 Reds. His 14th of the season.
A loopy slider that stayed in the middle of the strike zone for Frazier. He has tremendous plate coverage. Long arms, stands far off the plate, but can reach the outside corner, and that pitch on the outer third ends up in the basket.
Reds with a couple of leadoff homers tonight. Cozart in the first, Frazier in the fourth. Backhanded on the shorthand, short hop rather, and Cairo had problems getting out of the batter's box. Not quite sure what happened. I took my eyes off him, but he was about 10 feet out of the box when Valbuena was throwing over to first.
See if he slipped out of the box or just thought that was going to be a foul ball. I think he just thought it was going to be a foul ball, but Valbuena was able to get in there and smother it in fair territory on the backhand. Plenty of time to toss across for the out.
Strike on Mesoraco. Coming off the DL today. The concussion DL. Around the time he got hurt, I think it was the same game actually. Suspended, making contact with an umpire as he grounds out. Three games for making contact with umpire Chad Fairchild while arguing balls and strikes on behalf of his pitcher on July 30th, but he has appealed, so trying to get maybe a game knocked off before he serves that suspension. One and one on Leak. Steven Strasburg having a great year at the plate. Castro will charge. Stretch by Rizzo, and that's the inning. Frazier leading off the frame with a homer to make it 3-1 for the visitors. ability question. The Reds all-time hits leader is the all-time hits leader of all time, Pete Rose. Who's second in Reds history?
Good question. Mike Leake?
How about Barry Larkin?
Yeah, Larkin would be a great choice.
We'll find out. Are you going to look it up? Come on, it's a Reds.
I'm looking for something else.
Oh, okay.
I want to see who was third.
Got it.
I'm anticipating tomorrow's question.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with Barry Larkin without any other thought. That was the first name that popped in my head. Here's Rizzo, Cubs trailing 3-1. I'm going to look up Pete Rose and see how many hits he had with the Reds. .4256 combined, 3,358 with Cincy, .826 with the Phillies, .72 in one season with the Expos. At least part of a season. Two to Rizzo, flared in the left. It'll get down for his second hit of the night, and he's going to try for two. Safe at second. That's a double.
Once again, the Reds trying to go up the ladder. It is elevated at the top of the strike zone, but Rizzo gets to it. Got jammed. A floater out in front of Ryan Ludwig. The spin move and throw to second base, not nearly in time. Good hustle by Rizzo out of the box. That's where you get doubles between home and first.
Kick the pitch to Soriano. In on the hands, and he fights it off foul.
Back to that trivia question, you always go back to the big red machine. Dave Concepcion, another guy that could possibly be up high on that list. Tony Perez, maybe Johnny Bench, but I think you're right on with Barry Larkin.
Because he spent his whole career with the Reds.
Right. And he was a good hitter.
And he was a really good hitter, yeah. I mean, that goes without saying. Hall of Famer. This will be backhanded by Cozart, and Rizzo will take off for third. Throw there, out. So a double play, 6-3-5.
Good in theory, but not in execution. You can see he backed up almost all the way to second base. Really, the only way that play works, number one, is if you have a first baseman that doesn't throw well. Number two, if you can hold your ground as a runner at second base after your secondary lead, then you have a chance. If you go this far back to the bag at second, it's going to take a bad throw in order for you to be safe at third base.
And Cairo, by the way, I mean, he throws like a guy on the left side of the infield, so that's not a difficult throw for him to make at all. He's played a lot of third in his career. Cozart, and that's it. Just like that, the inning's over after the leadoff double by Rizzo, and it's still 3-1 Reds. eligibility question. Pete Rose, the Reds' all-time hit leader. Who's number two on that list? Actually, he's number two on a bunch of lists. And it is Barry Larkin. 2,340 hits. And look at that.
Second to Pete Rose in the first four categories. Second to Joe Morgan in stolen bases in Reds history.
Underway in the fifth. Top of the order for the Reds. Cozart, one bounce right to Luis Valbuena. It's weird, Bob. I mean, Volstead's getting ground ball outs, but the times he's elevated, he's been hurt.
He just loses any semblance of movement on that sinker. When he gets it up around belt high or a little bit higher than that, it tends to straighten out. Hitters get a real good look at it. When he has that pitch down in the zone, because of his height out there on the mound and the downward plane on that sinker, when he has it down in the zone, it's very tough to make solid contact. End up hitting a lot of easy grounders.
Down the right field line. Long run to Jesus over there and can't get it, and it's just foul. When you get that close to the wall, it's either out of play or fair. It's very tough to actually have it land on the field and be foul. Look how close the line is. Yeah, it hit the pad.
Yeah, it looked like it scraped the pad on the way down. I don't know if we've ever really seen one in that area that hit in that little bit of ground between the foul line and the padded wall.
Two pitch, foul tip, strike three. Olstad has fanned three. And it's Phillips with two outs.
For Stubbs, that strikeout number 104 on the season. A lot of comparisons being drawn, and it's still very early on between Brett Jackson and Drew Stubbs. Primarily because they both play the same position and they both have a propensity for the strikeout.
Was a changeup, and it's hammered into the alley. And Phillips has a two-out double. Hanging change, and Phillips made him pay.
Ooh. That went up pretty good toward the gap in right center field. We mentioned that strained calf muscle doesn't appear to be bothering Brandon Phillips in the least. He's got around those bases in a hurry.
Ludwig with two outs and a runner at second, and ball one on the slider. The coach got fired today. Scott Radinsky, the pitching coach of the Cleveland Indians. Replaced by Ruben Niebla on an interim basis. He was the Indians' AAA pitching coach. lot of coaches canned over the past couple of weeks around baseball. One gets away from Clevinger and just now locating it.
Clevinger thought that ball hit him in the chest protector and dropped straight down in front, but when he looked down there, the ball was gone. It trickled over to his left, allowing Phillips to advance on to third base with two outs.
A rare trade within the National League Central Division. Tyler Green sent from the Cardinals to the Astros. The player to be named or cash considerations. There's ball four. We'll see Tyler Green next week when the Astros come in. Nothing on Jay Bruce. You mentioned the little kind of tick he has before he gets ready to hit, which is that back arm straight up when he gets ready to bat. And every time he's hit since, it's been about 3 years, I notice it. Never noticed it before. Our AT&T U-verse multi-view. Watch that left arm right there.
The first time I thought he was requesting time out from the home plate umpire, but then I realized he does it every pitch.
Well, if he missed the last one, he'll do it again.
He'll do it again, yeah. Ask him how that got started. Sometimes it's an injury. Maybe he had a swollen left elbow, and before he grabbed a hold of that bat, he wanted to stretch it out one last time. Not really sure why he does it, but we know he does it.
Will never be able to erase it from your mind.
Nope.
Swing and a miss to end the inning. Good heat 93 from Volstead. Brett Strand 2 and lead by 2.
Third baseman, Lewis. not point out.
Cap, thank you. Mike Leek with a 3-1 lead here into the bottom of the fifth.
If you watch a Reds catcher, Devin Mesoraco, back there behind home plate, it's pretty apparent that they feel like Mike Leek can get a lot of these Cubs hitters out with pitches up above the letters. I mean, he has sat up high on his haunches on as many pitches as he's gotten down low at the bottom of the strike zone.
Action in the Cubs bullpen. That's Alberto Cabrera.
Chris Volstad's spot due up fourth in this inning. Should the Cubs get down there with an opportunity to possibly push across a run, I'm sure we'd see a pinch hitter and Cabrera would take over on the hill.
Ask for time before the 3-2. Leek from San Diego went to Arizona State and was the eighth overall pick in 09. Went right to the big leagues in 2010, and that's over Brandon Phillips.
It's good news for somebody because Qdoba is giving the first 20,000 fans a chance to win free food. The Cubs get a base hit in the fifth inning, which they've already done. Fans with a base hit for Burrito's game card win a free entree.
Brett Jackson popped out to the shortstop in the second inning, hitting seventh as he makes his Wrigley Field debut. Been here just a few times as a fan. First time as a player. Talking with Josh Vitters before the game, he said the only other time he had been here at Wrigley Field is after he signed. Cubs took him in the first round of the draft. He said, it seems different this time. It's better because I'm playing. Well, not in the lineup tonight, but we may see him off the bench.
He's ready to hit.
Leek came up in 2010, made the opening day rotation. He was the first player to go directly to the majors since Xavier Nady did it in 2000. Leek has only made two minor league appearances in his career in one start. That was last year. That's it. Not even eight innings of minor league work. Everything else has been in the bigs. Jackson chased a pitch in the dirt for the first out.
Well, that's the thing that really set Mike Leek apart from a lot of other pitchers at his age. That's a pretty crafty move right there to bounce that breaking ball on home plate. He's read the scouting report on Brett Jackson. He knows he's a free swinger. He knows he'll chase pitches out of the zone. So rather than throw the perfect breaking pitch, he's willing to bounce it up there on home plate and count on the hitter being overly aggressive and swinging at that pitch. That's usually something that comes much later in a player's career, that willingness and ability to throw pitches out of the zone to get out.
when you look at this list of guys going directly from the draft to the major leagues, most of those guys are college players. You go back to Dave Winfield, 1973, from the University of Minnesota to the Padres. Bob Horner did it, went from Arizona State to the Braves. Jim Abbott, University of Michigan to the Angels. Clevenger says, no, I've been back there all night, Mr. Nelson. And that wasn't a strike.
Our Liberty Mutual pitch tracks, I think it would tend to agree with Steve Clevenger. Tailing action on that fastball, took it right off the outside corner.
Steve is out of the game. Clevenger saying to Jeff Nelson, he threw the pitch in the same spot twice. The first one you called a strike, the second one you didn't.
Serenity now. First one we showed you on our Liberty Mutual pitch tracks had some tailing action, took it off of the outside corner. You see where Mesoraco set up. He catches a ball on the left side of his body. And that one was a couple of inches off the outside corner. And Leek, being the crafty pitcher that he is, comes right back and tries to throw the identical pitch. This one a little further away, but Clevenger clearly told Jeff Nelson it's the same pitch. Can't do that. Can't argue balls and strikes at the major league level. Some umpires will let you get away with it, especially a catcher. But Jeff Nelson not in the mood after an hour and 20 minute rain delay tonight. That was a quick trigger on Steve Clevenger.
So Castillo will come up with a 1-2 count.
Not good on a number of fronts. Cubs don't have a third catcher on the roster. Asked Dale before who would be the emergency catcher if you had to go that route. Darwin Barney's the guy that caught, I guess, back in Babe Ruth or something. It's been a while. You start looking at your utility players. Luis Valbuena, possibly. I don't know if he's ever been back there before. Adrian Cardenas, possibly. Joe Mather would volunteer to do it, I'm sure.
Sure he would.
Yep. But hopefully you get through the rest of this ball game without incident. Wellington Castillo can finish it up. If you had an electronic strike zone, that would never, ever happen. Ever.
Those pitches both would have been called balls.
Yeah,
that's for sure. It's Castillo. Foul tips for the strikeout. Strikeout, according to Bob Rosenberg, is charged to Clevenger. Nothing on Volstead.
An oddity there. Mike Leek with a drop down nearly sidearm delivery to the opposing pitcher. Normally you reach into your bag of tricks when you've got runners in scoring position facing a tough hitter. You want to give him a little bit of a different look, but for the first time tonight, Leek alters his delivery against Chris Volstead.
Sharply hit grounder to the shortstop Cozart. He flips to Phillips. Two in the inning. Leadoff single and an ejection in the fifth. 3-1 Cincy. Baseball season is in full swing, so is the WGN Radio Cubs Corners, sponsored by Wintrust Community Banks. The next Cubs Corners is coming Tuesday at Wildfire. Join Dale Swain, Jeff Samardzija, and James Russell for a live WGN Radio broadcast. And enjoy a great three-course lunch, all for just $55. Tickets are available now by calling 312-787-9000 or visiting Cubs.com. So Castillo stays in to catch after replacing the ejected Steve Clevenger. And Chris Volstead is back out there for the sixth inning. Facing Todd Frazier, took him deep on the first pitch of the fourth. DeJesus coming over. Does not have a play. Ooh, he banged hard into the padded wall. But it is okay.
The wind has picked up even a little bit more here in the top half of the sixth inning. Really pushed that one away from David DeJesus down the right field line.
I was going to ask you this, but the inning ended. In terms of an electronic strike zone, as a former catcher, that would make pitch framing totally irrelevant. Are you okay with that?
Yeah, I am. I mean, I think it is an art form, and I think some catchers are considerably better at it than others. But
a strike is a strike, and a ball is a ball. That's your
opinion. A strike is a strike.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not disagreeing with you, just playing devil's advocate. Now, would the strike zone change based on the batter and his height?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, it says that in the rule book.
Yes. Hooked in the left. Soriano will come and get it, but Frazier will just get in. Well, that was a lot closer than I thought it would be. Just got his hand in for a leadoff double.
Soriano and Darwin Barney made it a close play. Soriano with the bare-handed pickup out in the left field corner. Strong throw just a little bit to the infield side of the bag. Barney, as always, takes the throw and goes to the base. Unfortunately, Frazier was already there.
Cairo went. Call made by Alan Porter at first. The biggest impediment, I think, to a, a logistical impediment to a an electronic strike zone is what we are looking at right now. There are very few parks, and they're all brand new parks, in which the center field camera is directly above and centered over the pitcher's mound. So it's a straight line. Most ballparks, you're a little right of center, so that gives you a kind of a skewed look at the strike zone. And I think the only way to do the electronic strike zone is via cameras, right? Well, or do you think you can put some sort of laser box up there?
Well, they did it with Questech. You know, for a number of years there, there were selected ballparks, which is a built-in inequality, to have it in some parks and not in other parks. But it was adjust for the hitter. You could raise the top part of the strike zone depending on the height of the hitter. Used some kind of laser beams to shoot across home plate. This is the Steve Clevenger at bat. On the right on the pitch number two was the one that was a called strike. And then pitch number three just a little bit further outside. But Clevenger was clearly indicating to Mr. Nelson that he felt it was the same pitch in the same location. But to finish your question, Questech was a system that Major League Baseball came up with to help evaluate the umpires. And it gave them a little bit of wiggle room on those pitches on the corners. I think it was 2 or 3 inches leeway off the corners and around the edges of the zone, both high and low.
Yeah, Frazier caught up. A tag applied, and they keep Cairo at first. That was the key part of the play. Not allow the batter slash runner to get all the way to second and essentially replace Frazier.
But the Questech system was in place to evaluate the umpires, to help them evaluate themselves and make changes as they deemed necessary. And it would seem to me like if it's a good enough system to grade the umpires on, it's a good enough system to use to call the balls and strikes.
One and nothing on Mesoraco. He broke his bat. No, I guess not. One and one.
We just came from San Diego, where Yasmani Grandal was on the disabled list with a pulled oblique muscle, but he came up through the Reds organization about the same time as Devin Mesoraco. They had a log jam at that position. Only one of them was going to be the everyday catcher at the major league level, so Grandal was traded. And Mesoraco is a guy that the Reds are going to have behind the plate for quite some time.
Left center, Soriano. Two down. Weeknights don't miss Chicago Tribune Live on Comcast Sportsnet. Tomorrow, 5, Tribune writer Bob Fulton and WBBM AM's Dave Kerner will join Cap to discuss today's hottest sports topics and set the table for the night ahead. Chicago Tribune Live, presented by Smirnoff, tomorrow night at 5 on Comcast Sportsnet. 1-0 on Leak. Called strike. Castillo is ready to fire to first.
You know, those pickoff attempts, or in that case a bluff pickoff attempt, a lot of times you don't get the borderline call from the home plate umpire because you're moving so much getting into a throwing position. But that time they did get the call on that pitch right on the outside corner.
Brett Jackson will make the grab, and that'll end the inning. Leadoff double by Frazier, but no runs. Still 3-1.
Coors Light freeze cam after a leadoff double in the fourth inning. Anthony Rizzo, if he could have held his ground right there where he is now, maybe he has a chance to advance to third base. But as Cozart fields the ball, he retreats back toward the bag at second base and then tries to change his momentum and advance to third. Miguel Cairo with a strong throw across the diamond to Todd Frazier for the out at third base.
Top of the order, starting with David DeJesus. Captain Morgan Stretch coming up later. Hall of Famer Billy Williams. Yankees beat Detroit 4-3. They won the final two games of that series to take a 2-2 split. Joe Girardi got ejected in the middle of that game. Yankees ended an 8-game, one-run decision losing streak. Their longest since 1944. Why is it that we always find out the quirky numbers on the Yankees? First time this guy did that at Yankee Stadium since 1927, whatever. What a play by Mesoraco! Wow. I've never seen a Cub catcher do that. You've got that little nook right next to the dugout, and he used every inch of the playing field to make this catch. Do you ever do that?
No. and hung onto his mask the entire time. Now, catchers are usually instructed to get rid of the mask to allow you to use both hands if necessary, but boy, how did he know where he was? He never really looked off of that pop-up. Well, right there, I guess, as he got to the on-deck circle and then somehow found that notch, was able to make a great catch right on top of the Cubs' dugout.
Well, that reach right there as Barney slaps one in the left. If he takes another stutter step to the right, Mesoraco may end up tumbling down the steps into the dugout. And on that side of the field, you're not going to get a lot of help.
It's about as well as you can possibly do it right there. Long run from that home plate area. Maneuver your way through the on-deck circle with the lead bats and the rosin bags and the pine tar rags. You got a ball boy and a security guard over there, and somehow Mesoraco managed to get through all of it and make the play.
Strike on Rizzo. RBI single in the first. And a double in the fourth. It's that cutter, 0-2.
Leak missed his spot badly. Once again, Mesoraco wanted that pitch up near the top of the strike zone. It was down and in, but had enough movement that Rizzo couldn't get it.
Anthony's batting average has gone up 10 points tonight from 291 to 301.
One thing you may notice about Mike Leak from the stretch position, he starts with the ball in his glove. You can see the bare right hand right there. And when he tries that quick pick over at first base, it's always going to take a little bit longer because he has to reach into the glove, grab the ball, and then make the throw to first base. I bring that up only because former Cub pitcher Rick Sutcliffe had a tell. He did the same thing as Mike Leak. He would put the ball in his glove, get the sign from the catcher, go into his stretch position. But if he was going to quick pick at first base in the middle of his delivery, he held the ball in his right hand.
It's a giveaway.
So if you were an observant base runner or had a first base coach who paid attention to the game, you could tell when Rick Sutcliffe was going to try that quick pick at first base.
This is a slider out in front of the plate. 2-2. Behoove the Cubs to do a little damage here against the starter because their bullpen has been so good. Best bullpen ERA in the majors. Barney runs, ball four.
Same cut fastball down and in that Anthony Rizzo swung at earlier in the sequence. Mike Leak tried to go right back to it again there on the 3-2 pitch, thinking he might get in to chase another one, but this time Rizzo identified it quickly and laid off for ball four. Got some instant offense here.
Two on, one out, and the pitch to Soriano. Backed off the plate, and it was inside. Keep thinking this is a Monday because it's a night game, but it's a rare Thursday night game. Unless there's a little bounce in everybody's step. The reason is the weekend's coming.
All I know is it's not Sunday.
It's a strike.
Sunday you get the big thick newspaper. Every other day of the week it's all the same.
So You know what day of the week it is once every week.
Once a week I can identify but the day.
The only thing is sometimes you get that Sunday paper on a Saturday. That'll really mess you up. One and two. Get that maximum lead there at second base.
Well, ideally, that's what a base runner should have to do. When the ball gets past the hitting zone and the hitter doesn't offer at it and the catcher has the ball, you should have to slam on the brakes, and at least your first couple steps back to the bag should be hard. Get out there in a position where you feel like you're almost too far out there, but as soon as the ball gets by the hitter, turn and bust it back to second base. Talked to Darwin Barney last year about his budding relationship with Brandon Phillips, fellow second baseman. He loves to watch the way Brandon Phillips plays the game. And got to know him a little bit playing against him last year. They're having a little chat out there at second base right now. Four errors combined.
A long errorless streak at second base. 2-2. Five consecutive errorless games at second and counting. That's a single season club record.
They have four errors combined. I know a guy that made four in one inning.
Oh yeah, me too. Zarocco able to hang on. Two outs.
Mutual pitch tracks look like a changeup. Actually, that's a fastball. A lot of downward movement on it.
Castro drives that ball out into deep left center. It is off the wall. Barney scores. Rizzo coming home. Here it is. Save. Castro will end up at third. We're tied.
No wind, that ball is out of here. Drew Stubbs quit on it rather quickly out in center field. It banged high off the bricks. With two outs in the inning, everybody's motoring on the bases. Boy, and the difference between safe and out at home plate was just a slight mishandling of that relay throw. It took Zach Cozart an extra tick to get rid of the ball. That's all Rizzo needed to crash into Devin Mesoraco and tie this one up.
Big hit for Castro. Had been scuffling mightily. So we're back to even. Here's Valbuena trying to give the Cubs the lead and give Chris Volstead a shot at a win. They are going to give the shortstop Cozart an error, allowing Castro to get to third.
Tough error for Cozart, but like I said, just an extra tick getting rid of that ball. Stubbs got it back in through the cutoff man, but Cozart apparently couldn't find a good grip, immediately had to take an extra step before delivering that throw to home plate. Castro hits that same ball in the first four innings of this game. Cubs would have a lead. That wind really blowing in from left field now. No doubt it held that ball up.
Ball four, and comes Brett Jackson. Walks on the night by Leak. They both come here in the sixth. Brian Price, pitching coach of the Reds, is out to the mound. Jose Arredondo, that excellent split finger fastball, is up in the Reds bullpen. Kind of interesting, though, last major league team to go all 162 using only five starters, the 2003 Mariners, and the pitching coach was Brian Price.
Center fielder number seven, Brett Jackson.
Side corner strike.
You know, Len, I don't recall ever seeing him use it, but I would venture a guess that Mike Leake has a pretty good fake to third, pick to first move. He's just one of those guys that does all the little things so well out there on the mound, and I would assume that's one of them that he has in his back pocket.
Two and one. The ground. Cairo slips, but he beats Jackson to first base to end the inning. Starlin Castro with a drive off the wall in center to knock in two to tie the game 3-3. upcoming series against division rivals, the Houston Astros, beginning Monday. To purchase tickets, visit Cubs.com, call 1-800-THE-CUBS, or visit the Wrigley Field box office. It is raining a little harder now as Manny Korpis will face the top of the Reds' order, starting with Zach Cozart. Slider misses outside. We want to say hello to a lifelong Cub fan, Wally Behan, deputy fire chief for the Bloomingdale, Illinois Fire District. He has served there since 1980. So, Wally, hang in there. We hope you get well soon.
Absolutely.
Bob, it just means that one of these fans will be singing in the rain here in a few minutes.
I like it. You gonna do your Gene Kelly impersonation?
No. Valbuena, one away. Not much of a difference. Only two differences. Lee had one more strikeout, and Volstad gave up two homers. End it all up. 3-3 tie. Korpis with the tongue depressor, which will never be used as a tongue depressor again. Is that one? Hey, Saturday, it's a Central Division showdown as Anthony Rizzo and the Cubs look to slow down Dusty Baker's first place Reds. Coverage starts at 2:30 with Subaru Cubs pregame live. Cubs and Reds Saturday, 2:30 on Comcast Sportsnet. Fans' best friend. Bronson Arroyo and former Red Travis Wood. Pitching matchup on Saturday. Valbuena again to his glove side to get Stubbs.
On his game, that's what Manny Korpis will do to an opposing offense. The combination of that sinker, he'll change speeds on it. He throws the slider from a variety of arm angles. The slider has a lot of downward movement. When he's good across the bottom of the zone, he gets a lot of ground balls.
Phillips 2 out of 3. Apparently able to get the bat back. So Valbuena playing back at third.
It's another indicator that Brandon Phillips is 100% healthy if he's thinking about bunting for a base hit, something he doesn't do a lot of, but obviously that calf muscle is fully healed.
As you said, Phillips plays with a little more flair than Darwin Barney does, but they both get the job done at second. They both have a big bat waggle in the batter's box. Phillips hits for a lot more power. And he punches that one into right for his third hit of the ball game.
Just kind of flips this one out into right field. No stride at all with that front leg. A lot of hands involved in the swing. Poke it out there to the opposite field. Take the base hit. because he is feeling so good, apparently, with that calf injury. You got to keep an eye on him over there at first base. 9 attempts on the season, because he has had some leg injuries throughout the early part of the year, but 9 stolen base attempts. He's been successful 8 times.
Valbuena, busy inning. Gets it to Barney. Captain Morgan, seventh inning stretch. Billy Williams, his grandson's coming up.
Take me out to the ball game. Cubs Hall of Famer, Billy Williams.
Cub fans, it finally happened. 10 is in. The Hall of Fame, Ron Santo. Let's sing out loud. Take me out to the ball game. A one, a two, a three. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jacks. I don't care if I ever get back. So let's root, root, root for the if they shame, for it's 3 strikes you out at the old ball game. Let's get some more runs.
The rain has pretty much stopped. That's good news. Jose Arredondo against catcher Wellington Castillo in a first pitch strike. Billy Williams is with us in the booth. Billy, always great to see you, and a nice tribute to Ron Santo.
Well, it's good to be here, and we had so much fun. I went down to Dallas in December, and of course Jane Clark announced that Ronnie was in the Hall of Fame. I tell you, it shot both to my heart, because we played so many years together, and he wanted it so much, and when it happened, it was great. And the ceremony in Cooperstown this past July, we had a great time up there. A lot of Cub fans came from Chicago, too, because
sure,
they wanted to see it, too. Ronnie played his heart out here. He did a great job on the radio here, so everybody was pulling for him.
I think it's great that your statue and Ron's statue are right next to one another out on Addison and Sheffield.
It really is, and it was a great tribute to the both of us, because we played so many games, over 2,000 games together, and when I ride past my statue, I see Ronnie, it brings back a lot of memories. And I got a picture, I'm going to try to get it, you know, bronze and gold and something put out there, and it's Ronnie and I on this pitch, and it, the top of it is we played in over 2,000 games together. Yeah. And we just enjoyed the game of baseball. Of course, when we went to San Antonio, we had a good coach down there by the name of Grady Hatton, who was a baseball player that played some outstanding baseball in the Major League. And, of course, Roger Hornsby was our hitting coach. And these two guys put hit their finger on and say, one day you guys going to be in the big league. So we couldn't go wrong with those two guys.
Good instructors. You showed us that great picture of you and Ronnie when you were both young in San Antonio. You know, I was looking at some numbers, Billy. A lot of people probably don't realize Ron Santo's first year in pro ball when you guys played together in San Antonio, he made 53 errors.
Well, he was a catcher at first, you know, and they put him at third base. When he first signed, they signed him as a catcher. Matter of fact, they signed me as a third baseman, and I went to the outfield. And Ronnie was a catcher when he first came to San Antonio. Then they put him on third base. And always, you know, Ronnie always said, a good third baseman have a strong chest and a good arm. Yep. I hear you talk about that. And he did have a good strong arm, and he had a tough chest. But he made a lot of errors at third base, but he made himself a great player because I often said, Ronnie, you know, he couldn't get to point A to point B quick, you know, but he was always anticipating the ball going to be here or the ball going to be there. He got himself in good position.
It's Battery trying to get things together here. 3-3 tie. Starlin Castro tied it in the sixth.
Well, I'm concerned about who will catch if something happened to Castillo.
We were talking about that, yeah.
Yeah. You know, when you got two catches, you got to be a little cautious on what you do.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes you have a third guy that's a utility player that can go back there in an emergency, but I don't think we have that guy on this roster.
I heard at one time Barney has done that. You know,
it was a long
you don't want to interfere with what we have there because he's going to be our future second baseman. I really feel that way because he know how to play the game. He could do things. He got a feel for where he should be on a ball hit, and he does great things with the bat. Just like the first inning, he got the guy over, and you know, we scored a run.
Billy, I wanted to ask you, you had an opportunity. You come to spring training every year
I
with
do,
the Cubs.
I
you had
do,
a chance
yeah.
to see Anthony Rizzo in spring training in Mesa, and now different looking hitter now.
Really, really different. When he came to Arizona, you know, I saw a guy with a long swing, and this was his holdback. You know, they was throwing the ball inside to him in the past years, and he just wasn't getting to the ball. But I saw him as a player when he first came back here in Chicago. You know, he's relaxed at the plate. His swing is short. And he's getting to the ball inside. And I said when he first came up to the big league, you know, the Boston signed him at a young age. And they traded him to San Diego. And he still didn't know whether or not he could hit big league pitching after the AAA series we had down there. But he was great. But when he came to the big league here, I was hoping that he'd get off to a good start.
Castillo foul.
Ooh. I was hoping he'd get off to a good start, which he did. And right now, his confidence is real high. He's putting the bat on the ball. And I said that he could get some home runs to left center field. He stayed with the ball pretty good. And he's pulling the ball down the right field line. He hitting the ball to left field. So I think we got a first baseman that's going to be here a while.
Mm-hmm. Is that swing?
Mm-hmm.
We're talking with
well,
the guy who had the sweet
that's
swing.
That's a base hit right there, a base hit to left field.
Yep.
But he stayed on the ball. And what happened, if a left-hander pitching, he stay on the ball real good, too. And this makes left-hander hitters successful when you can stay in on a left-hander like he does.
Brian LeHaire is going to bat in the pitcher's spot. Billy played in 1,117 consecutive games, September of 63. In September of 1970, that was a National League record at the time. Do you remember the game you ended up ending the streak?
I do. I remember like it was yesterday because I came to the ballpark. Matter of fact, we was on the road, and I told Leo, I said, you know, we played in a lot of games, and I didn't feel that I was doing the things to help the ball club win. I might have went to second base. I could have gone to third. And I say I got to take out a lineup because I'm not helping the ball club win. So we on the road, and Leo said, and we talked about it. And when we get back to Chicago, you know, we're going to give you a day off. And I remember coming to the ballpark.
Can you hang on to this? We'll tell it after the break.
I sure will.
All right.
I sure will.
Billy Williams telling us about the day he sat out. It's the Honda call to the pen. There's the Billy Williams statue. We'll be back. Honda call to the pen and a familiar left-hander. Cub Sean Marshall against Brian LeHair. All right, so
when I came to park that morning, Joey Malfitana met me at the door and said, "You can go back home if you want to." And I said, "No, I'm going to stay at the ballpark." But in the meantime, I walked in and put on the uniform. And I remember for 9 innings, I was in the clubhouse. I was down in the bullpen. I came to the bench. I didn't know what to do with myself.
Sure.
I didn't know what to do because I was in so many games, and my job was to come to ballpark, play baseball, and try to do good and go back home. But that day, I was so confused. But after the game, you know, it was just like somebody taking 1,000 pounds of lead, taking me off, because I was kind of relaxed. And I went back home that night. Although I thought about it, I said, why did I take out of the game today? You know, I should have played. But after I done it, I felt fine. And then right after then, I started playing. I got my second win back and started to put up some good numbers again.
Well, that's why. Here's the 3-1, little dribbler foul. That's why most managers, even like a Derek Lee, a guy who never wanted a day off, It's probably a good idea every 2 weeks to give them just one, right?
Sure,
just to recharge
now,
your batteries.
Sure it is. Now, you know, you play a lot of games, and, you know, you begin to get bad habits up to the plate, and you try to do so many things. You're confused up to the plate, and all of a sudden, you know, if you take a day off, you feel refreshed coming into the clubhouse, going back on the field and play. I think every player now, you know, after you play so many games, give you a day off whether or not you need it or not. You used to do that on AstroTurf. You know, some of the guys play on AstroTurf, it just bothers their knees and back. But now with the travel, the games, and, you know, you got to give a guy a day off every now and then. Not only to help him physically, but help him mentally too.
Payoff pitch to LeHair, swing and a miss.
That's the ball they've been throwing him this year. The high fastball, they're throwing breaking balls and then get him out with the high fastball up.
We talked about there are a ton of great high ball hitters from the left side. It's mostly like it down. Jim Edmonds comes to mind. Good high ball hitter, but tough to lay off when you can see it, right?
Yeah, it really is. It really is. You know, I often said that when I first came to the big league, you know, your strike was from your armpit to your knees, and you had to hit the fastball. Every player that played the game at that time, they had their hands high. Now guys have the hand low because they don't call a high strike. But there's not too many left-handed hitters like to hit the high pitch. You know, most predominantly left-handed hitters are predominantly low ball hitters. And they could get to the low ball pretty good. If it's down and in, seemed like it's just a natural swing. I remember McCovey, you know, I'm playing first base and Dale Evans, and they hit some shots down. You know, the pitcher dropped the ball down and leave the ball down and in, and you could look for it to come down because they're going to pull it.
Logan Andrusik is up for the Reds. The 2-0 on the way to DeJesus. He was in there for a strike and a cutter. Wind blowing from left to right. Shifted a bit throughout the evening with the rain showers.
Good.
Phillips down to a knee. Will get DeJesus. Always a pleasure to talk with sweet swinging Billy Williams.
Well, it's good to chat with you guys.
Thanks, Billy.
Everything is great. Keep up the good work.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. All right, Bill.
Field to watch the Cubs battle the Astros next Monday night. Game time is 7:05, but be sure to arrive early. The first 10,000 fans at the ballpark will receive an exclusive limited edition Starlin Castro bobblehead, compliments of D'Agostino's. For more information and to purchase tickets, visit Cubs.com.
Here's veteran right-hander Sean Camp in a 3-3 tie. Mets lead in the division is 3 because the Pirates lost earlier today. It's been a rainy night here at Wrigley Field. Started an hour and 20 late. Not been interrupted since the first pitch. Change up for a strike. Called strike 3 on a slider.
It's a flat slider. He's trying to throw it to the outside corner. It actually catches a little bit more plate than he wanted, but right at the bottom of the kneecaps for a called strike 3. Yeah, Billy Williams looks like he can still get in that batter's box and hit.
He does. Well, one of the great thrills for us during spring training is standing around the batting cage for a Cactus League game and not only talking ball with Billy Williams, but looking at all the young players' swings and having him tell you what he thinks. Just break it down.
This guy's going to have trouble with off-speed pitches. Yep. This guy's going to have trouble with pitches on the inside part of the plate. It doesn't take him long to read a guy's swing.
Give him a break.
Picked up by Barney for the second out. Nationals shut out the Astros 5-0 in Houston. Michael Morris had 2 homers. That's a 4-game sweep. So the Nats have won 6 in a row. They're 69-43. One to Cairo.
Well, Castillo appealed down to the first base umpire, Alan Porter, but standing right behind Alan Porter is one of the Reds relief pitchers. It's protecting the catcher down there. So when home plate umpire Jeff Nelson asked for help, not only did Alan Porter signal safe, but whoever that is in the hoodie signals safe too.
That might be Sam LaCure.
I think you're right. Alternate first base umpire. Came prepared.
Yeah. camp ready. The wind and the 2-2. Sliders low and wide. Full count with Mesoraco next. Tampa Bay just swept the Blue Jays. 7-1 the final today. High in the air to deep left. Soriano back near the well. He's backing up. He's got it right up against the ivy. Again, the wind helping just enough to keep this game tied. Here on the Cubs as they host these Reds this Saturday at 3:05, but you'll want to get here early. The first 10,000 fans get a Cubs car mirror cover, compliments of Liberty Mutual. For more information and to purchase tickets, visit Cubs.com. 2-3-4 starting with Darwin Barney against former Cubs Sean Marshall. Sean still basically works backwards compared to most pitchers. You'll see a lot of off-speed breaking stuff early in the count. And he'll occasionally sneak a fastball by a guy with two strikes and lull him to sleep. That's the curve.
He throws that curveball about 38% of the time, throws a slider about 20% of the time. The rest are either tailing fastballs or cut fastballs.
Is a cutter. His cutter, Bob, really is just a really hard slider. And the slider's the slower version in terms of the movement.
And the slider has a little more lateral movement across the strike zone. The curveball, a little more vertical, drops straight down.
Well, we've said this before, but Sean was one of our favorites. And I know a lot of Cub fans hated to see him go. As the Cubs made a trade more for their future than their present. Travis Wood involved in that deal. Carlos Marmol up in the bullpen.
Sean Marshall is not a soft tosser by any definition. He has a good fastball in the low 90s that he can command. His breaking stuff is much better than the league average, but What a nice compliment to Aroldis Chapman. You've got a left-hander that can throw a variety of breaking pitches for strikes, and then you bring in the flamethrower, Chapman, who regularly hits triple digits.
Got him on the fastball. Sean did close early in the season. Closer was going to be Ryan Matson, but he had Tommy John surgery. Good night for Rizzo at the plate. RBI single, double, walk and a run. Way inside. Curveball, strike one, 1-1.
This is where you really don't know facing Sean Marshall. He could drop a curveball on Anthony Rizzo. He could throw a hard slider off the plate low and away. He could elevate a fastball. So many weapons at his disposal, especially against the left-handed hitter.
Just couldn't hang on.
In and out of the glove of Devin Mesoraco. Looked like that got him in a bad spot.
I was going to ask you earlier when he caught a foul tip, is there an art form to that, or is it, you know, you catch it when it's like a swing and a miss?
Well, you try to catch it like a swing and a miss. You're anticipating that the batter's going to swing and miss at the ball to begin with. And when he foul tips the ball, it always redirects it away from the pocket of your glove. Sometimes it'll hit down near the heel of the glove, sometimes off the thumb. That one appeared to hit out near the fingertips of the catcher's mitt.
Down a little bit on that curveball. Go up with the heat again. Didn't get him to bite. He's shown him just about everything. Both breaking balls.
That'll serve Anthony Rizzo well, regardless of what happens here on the next 3-2 pitch. He's going to face Sean Marshall a lot. The more pitches he can see, the better.
Inside on the curve for ball four.
Our BMO Harris pitch tracks that breaking ball. Just hung up on the inside part. Didn't quite make it back to the corner. Good battling at bat that time by Anthony Rizzo.
We've got Soriano and Castro due up. Wilson Valdez will come in as part of a double switch. Right-hander Logan Andrusek. So it is the Honda call to the pen. 3-3 in the eighth. We'll be back. behind a call to the pin. Logan Andrusik is the third Reds reliever to work here tonight. And he'll face Alfonso Soriano with a go-ahead run at first in Anthony Rizzo. Got some other changes. Wilson Valdez comes in to play third. Todd Frazier goes over to first. Miguel Cairo is out of the game. Andrusik has stranded 36 of 39 inherited base runners as he gets a swing and a miss from Soriano. Continues to rain.
Not only can that Reds bullpen pitch, but they'd make a pretty good offensive line. Everybody that comes out of that Reds pen is enormous.
Bunch of power forwards, too. Knocked down by Mizoraco. What a play. That ball bounced way out in front of home plate, and somehow he got a body part in front of it. I think it actually might have gotten a glove on it.
Either his body part or the umpire's body part. I'm not sure. That
one, you're right.
It got through Mesoraco, but catches Jeff Nelson behind home plate. Like I always say, there's no such thing as a bad block. Mesoraco going out to talk to Andrusik right now just to give the home plate umpire a chance to regroup.
Little diamond dry out on the mound, maybe help out the pitcher here.
A breaking ball or a splitter, not sure which one, but hit way out in front of home plate.
They manicure the mound, looking at their bullpen. I mean, newly acquired Jonathan Broxton, 6'4", 300. Aroldis Chapman is 100 pounds lighter, but the same height. Sean Marshall, 6'7", Andrusik, 6'8". Alfredo Simon, 6'6", 230. Yeah.
What's Sam LaCure? He's the point guard out there, I guess.
6'1", 207.
Oh, little guy.
Broxton.
Well, we talk about it every time we have rain here at Wrigley Field, which is often. The primary concern is the footing of that pitcher out there on the mound for obvious reasons. If he starts sliding around, that ball starts getting away, becomes a very dangerous situation. So quick touch up of the mound in the home plate area, and hopefully everybody's good to go.
So Rizzo at first, a 1-2 count on Soriano. Surprise, Andrusik's trying to bounce some breaking balls here against a guy who struggles with that pitch, especially with two strikes. And I'm sure Dave McKay reminding Anthony Rizzo of that too. At the very least get to second base no matter what Soriano does in this at bat. With Castro on deck, a chance to take the lead. Cubs have not had a lead in this game. deep to center. Drew Stubbs back on it. It is gone! A two-run homer. And the Cubs have their first lead of the night. Number 20.
Seen a couple of well-hit balls knocked down tonight, but Soriano absolutely crushes this one to straightaway center. He knew he caught it on the sweet spot of the bat. Stubbs started to glide back onto that warning track in center field, but realized that one's not coming back.
Big. His 11th straight 20-homer season.
Big home.
So he... David Ortiz and Albert Pujols, the only players to have 11 consecutive 20-homer seasons currently. He has joined Andre Dawson as the only Cubs to hit 20 or more in each of their first six seasons on the north side. Up by Castro, and Cozart will make the catch.
Steady diet of pitches down around the knees or even farther below the knees to Alfonso Soriano. Mesoraco wanted to go with a high fastball. Rusicura right down the middle of the plate, and Soriano absolutely crushed it.
So Carlos Marmol getting ready for a save chance. One run charged to Marshall, the other to Andrusik. Swing and a miss to end the inning. But Alfonso Soriano with a two-run blast. The Cubs have their first lead of the night as we go to the ninth. It's now 5-3.
News nightly on GMC Sportsnet Central. Coming up tonight after Horseshoe Casino Cubs postgame live,
Luke Stuckmeyer and Chuck Garfine will have Bears highlights and reaction against the Broncos. The latest update on Paul Konerko as well. GMC Sportsnet Central tonight after postgame live. Only on Comcast Sportsnet, fans' best friend. Double switch, Mather in left. And Marmol on the mound. Trying to snap an eight-game skid.
And the numbers for Carlos Marmol are dead even at this point of the season. He throws his fastball 50% of the time. He throws his slider 50% of the time. Last year, he threw his fastball only 36% of the time. 64% was the slider. We know that Dale Swaim encouraged him in the early part of the season to start using his fastball more, and he grudgingly did so. And as he started to throw more fastballs, the results started to come back for him.
I bet you that split was very similar to last year in the first month and a half this year.
Yeah.
Says Xavier Paul putting in a pizza order with the home plate umpire. Now, did you say thick crust?
Okay. You are in Chicago.
Paul hitting for Mesoraco. Like having that two-run lead here. Fastball misses. Ball one. This is the problem with a long losing streak, is that your closer doesn't get any chances. This is his first save opportunity since July 28th. Three and oh. Three appearances since that last save. Three innings total, one run allowed. And pretty efficient. 11 pitches, 17-10. To find the strike zone. See if it's a slider. No, it's a fastball. 3-1. Sometimes he gets back to where he needs to be with a slider, even if he's behind. Throw him a slider, you just come right back with another fastball now that he's found it.
Personally, I like the fastball myself, but Marmol has confidence in that slider to throw at any count.
It was a heater. I don't think over the course of the past 3 years we've seen him do this. And he's been getting people out doing it. All fastballs in a sequence. With the seed of doubt in the hitter's mind that that slider's lurking.
Well, it's more than lurking. Here it comes.
In the hole, backhanded by Castro, gets rid of it quickly. Safe at first. What an effort.
Perhaps because of the wet grass, Castro seemed like he didn't want to try to plant that right foot and get a little more on the throw. Just kind of turns and wings the ball across the infield, makes it close. Xavier Paul runs extremely well out of that left-handed batter's box. Rizzo with another nice long stretch, but Paul clearly beat the throw to first base.
Well, at least he hit his way on. Marmol got back into the strike zone. And now it's Wilson Valdez. About two on a one hop. 4-6-3, two down. just like that, Marmol's one out away.
Our Home Depot doing more on defense. Hard hit ball on a hop to Darwin Barney. That's a beautiful thing. Plenty of time for Starlin Castro to get to the bag. Complete the strong relay throw to first. Nicely done.
Sliders outside to Cozart. Marmol's in his 13th year in the Cubs organization. Back when he was a catcher. Tying run back to the plate, and it's Drew Stubbs. This is his 35th inning of work. That's his 33rd walk. Stubbs walked in the first and scored 0 for 3 since. And he's missed now at 5 in a row.
I use the term a lot, Len, getting ahead of yourself. I think that happens to Marmol sometimes, especially after huge momentum swing, big double play there, two outs, nobody on base. Wanted to finish this game out quickly. His mechanics come apart a little bit. He loses that zone again. He's taking one pitch at a time.
Slider, 1-1. On the ground. Castro will throw to second. Got him! Cubs win. Close play at second, but they get the force play, and the Cubs say goodbye to an 8-game losing streak. Nice comeback win tonight. Castro tied it with the 2-run double in the sixth, and Soriano won it with a 2-run homer in the eighth.
There's a saying in this game, if you have to sit around and wait for a rain delay, you might as well win the ball game. Our player of the game, Alfonso Soriano, with a blast into the juniper bushes in straightaway center to give the Cubs their margin of victory.
Sean Camp gets a win. Sean Marshall takes the loss, and Carlos Marmol picks up the save. As the Cubs send the Reds to their season worst fifth consecutive loss. So for Bob and our entire crew, Len Casper saying so long from Wrigley Field. The final score tonight, the Cubs 5, the Reds 3. We're back on CSN, 2:30 for the pregame. on Saturday, game three of this four-game set. In-game scoring provided by ScorePad. You've been watching Cubs baseball on Comcast SportsNet, now part of the NBC Sports Group.